Special for you. I think she looks a little bit better than me, don't you agree? It is time, cover her head.
Timothy, verse 1, I mean, chapter 1, verse 7. For God had not given us the spirit of fear, but of power. Say that.
Power.
And of love.
Love.
And a sound mind.
Sound mind.
Can you remember that? Power, love, and a sound mind. But not fear. Just learned here that fear is not of God. Fear not, in some form, is the most repeated phrase in Scripture. It's been said, well, I didn't do the math, and I didn't go do all the count, and I just relied on a few sites I ran on Facebook, I'm sorry, the internet, Google, Yahoo, whichever one, that there is repeated more than 365 times in the Bible to fear not. That would be like one fear not for every day of the year. One place I even read there's really 366. That would take care of Libya. Now, another site I read, I'm a big computer person, running sites from here to there. You have to use discernment doing that. Because believe it or not, everything that is on the internet is not true. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
That's a way down the end. It can get you in trouble, actually.
Yes.
Can lead you into places you have no place going. Very innocently, you wind up in a site, and it's like, oh my God, how did I get here? Be careful, little eyes, what you see.
Amen.
Is there a fear that is trying to take hold of you right now? In the last little bit? Something that's troubling you, something that's eating at you. Well, I don't recognize that as a fear, but hold on. It's maybe there's a medical issue. And I know if we polled everybody in here, somebody's got a medical issue. Maybe every one of us do to some sort. Maybe you went through a family crisis. Maybe you have some financial worries. Maybe you're just not sure in the direction the world is going. Lord, if you were to come right now, would I make it to heaven? I hope that's one of your fears. I hope you hold to the Lord every day and question, Lord, am I right with you? Is my walk right with you? Anxiety, worries, fears. Do you know there's more people? And I'm sorry, I'm not speaking to anyone. So if this hits you, don't look at me and I'm not talking to you. There are more people in this world right now on mood-enhancing drugs than at any time in the history of mankind.
That's true.
If you go to the doctor and you express, you know, some of those fears, worries, anxieties, maybe I told you they run all those tests, can't find anything. Oh, you've got anxiety. We're going to put you on stuff for that. I can take care of that. A mood-altering, mood-enhancing drug. Does it work? Some of this is quite necessary medically.
Right.
Now, I'm not dispelling medicine. I thank God for medicine. Can't do any more than what God Almighty, the healer, intends for it to do. But I thank God for modern medicine. I thank God for doctors. If not, this little girl might not be standing here for you right now. Fear is one of Satan's most popular weapons that he uses against us. Worries and anxieties can overwhelm us in controlling our every move and our every decision. Have you ever made decisions out of fear? And later on it's like, why did I do that?
Amen.
There's so much craziness going on around us in this world today. You watch the news lately. We've got wars, conflicts, persecutions, violence, crime on every hand. Natural disasters, terrorism, economic uncertainty. I hate this one, be so glad when it's done. Political corruption, unemployment, your health, disease, and even death. We fear for our children's futures, we fear for our families, we fear financial future, we fear for our very safety. Children fear what they'll face in school. Christians have a fear of being ridiculed if and when criticized for their beliefs. That's going to happen more and more, folks. Be ready. You better know that you know. You better hide that word in your heart, because when you least expect it and you don't have that Bible thumper thing in your hand, somebody's going to ask you or corner you. You better be ready.
Amen.
You better be ready and prepared to give an answer to those that ask you in an hour of need.
That's right.
Christians have a fear of being ridiculed if and when criticized for their belief. And the list can go on and on and on. There actually is a lot that we do worry about. Mm-hmm. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Y'all be honest. Come on. We all want to go to heaven, right? That was yours. Yet, the reality, so much of what we spend our time worrying about never happens.
That's right.
We spend a lot of unnecessary time living under a weight. And it's the weight of what if? What if? But what if? But what if? Now, be honest. Have you ever placed yourself under that weight of what if? My dad had a saying, and a lot of people may have used it before, but he said, 99% of what you worry about never happens.
Amen.
Think about what you're worrying about. Think about who you are. Think about who you serve, who you belong to. I'm a daughter of Almighty God.
Amen.
How dare me? And I do a lot to myself. A lot to myself. But would you like to discover that the things that once set you down an anxious spiral, increasing your heart rate and your blood pressure and giving you sleepless nights, can no longer have the same fear-gripping effect on you? Have you ever been just gripped by fear out of your very gourd? It may not happen real quickly, but you can, with God's help, begin to break the chains of the spirit of fear.
Amen.
He wants to paralyze and ensnare and entangle you. Break the chains of the spirit of fear. You ready to do that?
Amen.
How many are ready to break some chains?
Oh, yeah.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
I knew you summoned me. Do you recognize me? Any of you? You may not yet, but I know you. I know each and every single one of you. Oh, I've been with you more times than you could possibly imagine. I've sat next to you while you worship. I've stood behind your pastor as they attempted to deliver messages. I've been in your classes, your Sunday schools. I've been with your children, your teachers. I've even been in your fellowship hall.
Leave me alone.
God.
I've been to your homes too. I've stood outside on your lawn, in your driveways. I've sat at your dinner tables. I've been with you in your bedrooms. I've rode with you as you drove to work, to the store. I've even walked with the children as they scattered off to school.
Oh God. I don't know how I'm going to be able to keep up with this. Make a good time for swim, keep up with my grades in school. I have to pass this test in order to make it to college. I don't want to let down my team, my coaches, my family. How am I going to keep doing this? I'm going to lose my mind.
I've enjoyed being with you in seemingly innocent situations while you're having fun. I sat right beside you in the movie theater when you watched that horror film. I enjoyed watching you squirm at the amusement park, especially when you screamed in terror. You see?
Why are you looking at me like that? Don't touch me. Did you touch me?
No.
Don't look at me like that. You're scaring me. I'm not watching this movie ever again. so scared. I know, I can't sleep at night about this. This is so scary.
Something you haven't recognized. Every single time. Every single time you allow me into your eyes, you are actually inviting me into your heart. I've been with you in the hospital. I've visited you frequently in your hospital beds. I've hung out with your doctors, your nurses, as they gave you diagnosis and treatments for diseases and issues that you accepted as true. You've been so open in my presence, so welcoming, inviting me to stay, and I've been happy to be with you. It is, after all, my job. It's what I'm trained for, what I live for, what I enjoy. So, of course, I'm happy to do it. You know, I've traveled the world. I've met many new people, caught up with old friends, and I've tried never to lose contact with anyone that I have ever met, which, of course, has kept me very, very busy. My schedule stays full. I am a hard worker. I take my job very seriously. I do it well. I'm persistent. I'm calculating. I'm aggressive. I'm even relentless, perhaps. So I ask you, in your own mind, your own thoughts, I'm not of your God. So who is it that you think sent me to be with you?
Authority to use that word. There were seven men in the Bible that thought they were all this and that and a bag of cookies. They went about doing whatever they did, probably just for a good pad in the pocket. You know what I mean? Chinga, chinga, ching. They went about doing things for the Lord, but really just to build himself up. Seven sons of Sceva, the word called him, they confronted someone possessed of the devil one time. And they started calling forth that devil. Come out. Come out. Come out. This is where the having the authority to use the word of God comes in. You better know that you know who you know. You better know that you're a child of God. And you have the authority to use this word. Because the devil jumped out of that man onto those seven sons of Sceva, beat them up so badly, tore them up, shredded their very clothes off of them, and they went running down the streets of town, naked, bruised, and afraid. You better know that you know and have the authority to use the word of God. God's words are life, soothing to our soul, calming to our spirit, so much so. You remember David? Little David playing on his harp, you know, playing with the sheep. Grabbed a sling, killed a giant. When Saul was still king, he was tormented by a spirit. Do you ever feel torment coming at you? Maybe in the wee hours of the morning. In the darkness of night, after you've allowed something to enter into your eyes, after you've conjured something up in your heart and in your spirit that is actually a lie, and you're allowing the enemy just to make it bigger and bigger and bigger until you are so bound in fear. This is how King Saul was. He was tormented. He would call for David. Go get that little shepherd boy. Go get David. Have him bring his harp. David would come before the king, and he would play his harp. The Spirit of God came along with David. That's who empowered him. David would play his harp. I don't know, maybe he sang a little song. Jesus loves me. Of course, Jesus hadn't been on the scene yet. God loves you. And that spirit would flee. It is written. Satan flees at the word of God. You have to know the word of God. You have to hide the word in your heart. Psalm 118:24 declares, and I love it in song, this is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice. We will rejoice. There's a tiny little word in that, W-I-L-L. It's your will. It's your will. It's what you decide you're going to do or you're not going to do. You wake up today. It's going to be a bad day. Do you know what? Let me declare to you today, there is no such thing as a bad day. Every day is a gift from God. Amen. The scripture declares, this is the day that the Lord has made. Don't call what he made bad. Because when he said it in order, back in Genesis, everything he done, he said, it is good. It's a good day. It's a good day. How are you looking at this day? What are you speaking into your day? I will. Lord, I choose. That's what that means, I will. I choose. No matter what comes against me today, Lord, I choose, I will rejoice and be glad in you. Amen. That's the way you start the day, ladies right. And gentlemen. That's the way you start today. Nobody else go up and oh, God, yes, it's going to be that day. Oh, I got this bill due and I don't have the money to pay it, Lord. This is the day the Lord has made. I choose to be glad and rejoice. It's not always easy, and you will have to choose. Some of us aren't very good about making choices. My thing is, when you give me too many, I get overloaded. Really. It's either A, B, or C. Sometimes that's three too many. You have to choose. You have to choose not to allow fear, anxiety, and worry to control your life. Who's the professional worriers? Y'all know that? They're not very good professionals. We have to choose to guard our heart and focus our mind on what is truth and what is just a what if. What if? There is fear in what if. Tiny little word again, if, leaves too many ends open. We might still at times feel afraid. But if you know God is with you, at times you may feel out of control. But you can take courage and be encouraged by the God who is in control. Come on, let me hear it. Amen.
Amen.
Yes. We may not know what this afternoon holds.
That's right.
We don't know what the future holds. I wish I knew what December 8th held. But let me declare to you, and I heard this. I don't know how many of you know the author of Max Lucado. I love you.
Yes.
He wrote an article. He had a prediction for November the 9th. But if y'all don't know yet, if y'all don't know where you live, November the 9th is the day after this election. Somebody's going to win. It may not be who you voted for. It may not be who you like at all. You may allow that spirit of fear to want to grip you. Max Lucado declared, and I'm here to reiterate and re-declare, no matter who is put in that White House, God is still in control. In Isaiah 26:3, the word declares, "Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on thee, because he trusteth in thee." You know the 23rd Psalm? All those verses there? I want to bring one before you, very, very front and center. Number 4. And if it's up there, read it with me if you would. Yea! Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, real loud, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. I will fear no evil. We have to choose not to fear. For me, a few months back, that was so difficult. I even forgot who I belonged to. I allowed the spirit of fear to grip me so tight and so hard with a medical diagnosis. So much so, I thought I started feeling symptoms. So much so, they thought it necessary to have an MRI. Which didn't look good. And that spirit of fear just rested on me. I cried and I prayed, but, and I know God never left me, but I felt abandoned. What had Jesus telling you on the cross? My God, why have you left me? Why have you abandoned me? That feet are gripping so hard. The test results were real. They said you're going to have to go for some biopsies. That was horrific. Dear Lord, what can you do to the human body as well? That fear just gripped me. Every step I took, I could hardly sleep at night. I lost almost 15 pounds. Just believing and accepting everything that was being fed to me.
Right.
You got this, and the test showed this, and this shows that. And all the while, I could feel a small little portion of you're a child. You belong to me. I'll be with you every step of the way. I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. I'm with you right now, even in this dark time, I'm with you. No matter what happens, you'll come through. Someone said a prayer of faith. Wasn't me. My faith was just about gone. I had glimpses and glimmers of it, but it was just about gone, just about dead. Someone said a prayer of faith. Someone touched God Almighty. When those test results come back, said you had every symptom. The x-rays, the MRIs, it showed. But there's nothing there. There's nothing there.
Amen.
My husband didn't see it. I felt it in the floor.
I've placed you in the palm of my hand.
hand of God there. We stand and we jump out. We're the man that takes us out. You can know that God is greater than your worst nightmare. He gives us the power to live courageously, there's a scripture for that, boldly, fearlessly in this life, when many things that surround us would tell us to be afraid. Be afraid. Be afraid. His truth whispers a lot of times, it's just a whisper, because our fears are so loud, and life around us is so loud, and everything else takes precedence, and everything else will cry out. That still, small, quiet voice saying, come unto me, come unto me, and I will give you rest. Rest in me. His truth, which is his word, whisper strong and sure to the very deepest core of your spirit if you'll listen. My child, fear not. I am with you always. Say it with me. Fear not. Say it big and loud. Fear not. Praise the Lord. I would encourage each of you, if you would like to scripture that's very encouraging. Actually, it's a whole chapter. You may want to read it today. And it's Psalm, the 91st, Psalm 91, chapter 91. Read Psalm, chapter 91. Don't be afraid. Praise the Lord. God is good.